Good evening, sir.
Good evening. Good evening.
Yes, sir. Can you switch on your audio,
I
sir?
Think,
I mean, video, sir.
If everybody's, yes.
We are not able to see your video, sir. Yes, sir.
No, no, because the network is dropping. That's
yes,
why
sir.
I switched off my video. Oh, yes, tell me. You can start.
Yes, yes, sir.
Yes. Yes.
Good evening, sir. This is good evening. This is Ignatius on behalf of Indian Medical Association, Medical Students Network, and Junior Doctors Network. It gives me immense pleasure to introduce to you Dr. Vengadakrishnan, who will be our judge for case presentation. Dr. K. Vengadakrishnan graduated from Calicut Government Medical College in Kerala and finished his post-graduation in MD General Medicine from G.R. Government Medical College, Jiwaji University, Madhya Pradesh. He has also been a junior resident in the Department of Emergency Medicine, AIIMS, New Delhi. He is currently a senior consultant physician and professor of medicine in Sri Ramachandra Medical College and Research Institute, Chennai. Apart from being the principal investigator of two trials, he has authored 4 chapters in API Update and has 24 publications in index journals, both national and international, to his name. He has been an examiner for various universities and is a specialist consultant for Telangana Public State Service exams. His tremendous administrative experience include being a chairperson for Skills Committee, Medical Records Committee, and Clinical Society. Once again, we welcome you, sir, and request you to say a few words to our audience today. Over to you, sir.
Good evening, all, and thanks for the nice introduction. So it's a pleasure for me to be a judge for this program. It's a good initiative from the organizing committee. So Sri Muthukumaran Medical College, they done, especially Ignatius, had done a tremendous job. It's good to have in this corona crisis, it's good to have scientific sessions like this. And for the participants, you be clear in what you are presenting. Right? So nobody is a loser here, nobody is a winner here. So if it is a winner, you got the first prize or second prize, whatever it is, they would have gone down only by maximum 5%. So that doesn't mean that you did not do well today. It depends on the best of the 6. So whatever is the best. But the best abstracts I have chosen. So I am really happy that for a second year and a pre-final year, you are able to coordinate with the other departments and bring out the good case reports. So very happy to see that. All the best for the presenters. So we'll start the first presentation.
I call upon Niranjan Raghavan, who will be our first presenter for this session.
Hi, am I loud and clear?
Yes, Niranjan, you're loud and clear.
Okay, let me know when I can start.
Please start.
Okay. Good morning, Dr. Vengadakrishnan, and to my fellow participants. So today, I'm Niranjan from Sri Ramachandra Institute of Higher Education and Research. And today's case is about a primary non-Hodgkin's lymphoma of the lacrimal sac. So this is a very simple, an interesting and a really rare case. So next. So the patient was an 80-year-old man who presented with history of swelling around the right eye for the past 2 months. These were his only chief complaints. Next. So the history of presenting illness was he had swelling around the right eye, which was insidious in onset and gradually progressing. He had history of increased watering of eyes too, which is the epiphora. Next. The negative history were there were no history of aggravating or relieving factors, associated pain, dryness of eyes, fever, or any other comorbidities. Next. So on examination, a swelling was palpated in the subcutaneous region of the right medial canthus, and the swelling was diffuse with 2 by 2 centimeters in size, and the swelling extended up to the lateral wall of the nose, and skin over the swelling was normal and no warmth or tenderness were noted. Next. So here's we can see the anatomy of the lacrimal drainage system, the lacrimal sac continuing down as the lacrimal duct. Next. So in investigations, radiology was the primary investigation, with CT of the orbit revealed a solid mass in the right medial canthus, which also caused bony erosion and extension into the nasolacrimal canal. Next. So here, unfortunately, I wasn't able to catch hold of the actual radiograph of the patient, but this is a very typical presentation where a mass evolving at the right medial canthus of the orbital cavity is shown. Next. So here in the infraorbital margin, there's enlargement of the right nasolacrimal canal with tumor infiltration. Next. So on biopsy, when incisional biopsy was done, where gross examination showed three gray-white tissues which were embedded in toto. Next. So in microscopy, small round blue cell tumors were found invading the underlying muscle bundles, which is a classical presentation of carcinoma. Next. So in here, we can see that we are monomorphic sheets of atypical cells on my left, and individual cells which have oval nuclei, dense chromatin, and increased nuclear to cytoplasmic ratio, and which was scanned, which you can see on my right. Next. So the background lymphocytes were positive for CD3 upon immunohistochemistry, and the tumor cells were negative for HMB45, ruling out a differential diagnosis of amelanotic melanoma. So with the light microscopy and the IHC features, a diagnosis of non-Hodgkin's lymphoma of B-cell type was given. Next. So on treatment modalities, the main three ones were radiotherapy, chemotherapy, and immunotherapy. So for radiotherapy, a conventional fraction schedule of two gray per day was given, which was 5 times per week, and the total radiation dose was around 50 gray. And on chemotherapy, the classical CHOP regimen, which was given, and it was in correlation to the intermediate grade histology of the patient's lymphoma. And immunotherapy wasn't tried on this patient, but rituximab is another alternate which can be tried. Next. So on discussion, these ocular and anal lymphomas constitute for 2% of all extranodal lymphomas, and lacrimal gland is the only orbital structure to contain the lymphoid tissue. And the primary diffuse large B-cell lymphomas are the most common among these types. And the doses recommended for chemotherapy varies and depends on the site and the histopathology of the NHL, and with no clear dose response evidence yet. Next. So on conclusion, we can see that this case highlights a very rare disease presenting in an extremely rare anatomical location. So these presenting features can be correlated with dacryocystitis, which is infection of the lacrimal sac. Thus, this differential diagnosis should be considered when evaluating these patients. Early diagnosis and management of a patient in a multidisciplinary approach is necessary, with expertise of ophthalmologists, pathologists, and oncologists for a good prognosis. Next. These are the references, and thank you so much for your time, sir.
Over to you, sir, for a question and answer session.
We are sorry, sir. I think your mic is not unmuted yet.
Your mic is not unmuted, sir.
Okay. Thank you. So, it's a very good presentation. It was a very excellent presentation, and the way he presented with the confidence for a pre-final year, so I really appreciate him. So he never had any difficulties or impeded hiccups during presentation. He has prepared very well.
Thank you, sir.
The questions are, what is the present condition of the patient?
So we weren't able to follow up the patient. Because he was an 80-year-old male and he had a consultant outside. Only the pathological studies were done at Ramchandra. So we weren't able to follow up the patient. I did try though, but we weren't able to track down the patient. But after the chemotherapy, there was slight improvement.
This was once the patient from outside?
As only the pathological investigations were done in our college.
What is the difference between non-Hodgkin's and Hodgkin's in presentation?
Sir, in presentation, usually the symptoms are usually the same, but in presentation, usually Hodgkin's is more localized and it has fewer and specific sites of metastasis or node involvement. Whereas in non-Hodgkin's, it's more diffuse. It has more number of nodal involvement. And in pathology, the main thing is we don't see the RS cells, the Reed-Sternberg cells, in the pathology, and B cells is the only is the most common presentation in non-Hodgkin's lymphoma.
So what was the regimen for this patient, you told?
We had that R-CHOP regimen with that cyclophosphamide and those...
For this patient.
Yes, sir.
R-CHOP was followed.
Yeah, the R-CHOP regimen was followed, sir. But I don't think the course was continuously followed because I think they didn't... I think they refused the cycles. I think very few cycles were tried, but I don't know if he was completely cured, but there was no surgical intervention done, and there was and the tumor did start reducing in size.
What are the risk factors for NHL?
Usually it can be genetic or sporadic, and we have even for sporadic we have virus involvement such as HIV and others, and genetic it can come under any other gene involvement.
Okay, great. I think we have finished the 7 minutes. Okay, thank you for the nice presentation. Thank you so much. We'll move on to the next presentation to Ignatius.
Yes, sir. Our next presenter for today will be Sivapriya Rajagopal. Over to you, Sivapriya.
Yes, thank you. Could you enlarge it, please? Thank you. I'm dying of thirst, but lack the strength to even drink water anymore. Next, please. I'm Sivapriya Rajagopal, a third-year medical student from Rajarajeshwari Medical College and Hospital, Bangalore, here to present a case on a water drinking disease diagnosed in year 2011. Next, please. Our patient is a 45-year-old premenopausal female, a homemaker and mother of two, hailing from Bangalore, Karnataka, and completed her post-graduation. Next, please. Her chief complaint was a history of polyuria, polydipsia, and nocturia for 1 month. Next, please. A history of presenting illness. The patient was apparently normal 1 month ago when she developed a gradual onset of increased frequency and quantity of passing out urine at a rate of about 3 times per hour out of the normal of 6 to 7 times a day and almost immediately after drinking water. And her urine output measured up to 4 to 5 liters per day. This was seen excessively at night and was awake at least 5 to 6 times a day to relieve herself. Next, please. She developed gradual onset of excessive thirst and consumed up to 10 to 12 liters of water per day and developed dryness of mouth, lips, and tongue, and then gradually developed skin dryness over her limbs. She had fatigability, early morning lightheadedness, and lost about 2 kg weight in a span of 1 month. Next, please. She had no complaints of headache, vision problems, or muscle cramps. Next, please. Medical past history. She is not a known case of diabetes mellitus, hypertension, psychiatric illness, or chronic illness of medical importance, and no previous surgeries were done. No history of drug use or any known drug allergy. Next. Family history suggests no history of breast or lung cancer, but presence of hyperparathyroidism in her sibling. Next. Personal history. Our patient consumed a mixed diet and had a normal appetite, normal bowel movements, however, had nocturia, disturbed sleep. She's a non-smoker and non-alcoholic and no history of substance abuse. Next. On examination, the patient is moderately built and nourished, well-oriented to time, place, and person. Her vitals were normal, no pallor, icterus, cyanosis, clubbing, lymphadenopathy, or edema detected. On systemic examination, no abnormalities detected. Review of systems, no fever, no hair or nail changes, no complaint of genitourinary problems like dysuria or hematological problems. However, she had dryness of her mouth, lips, tongue, and skin, and mild scaling over the limbs. Next. Laboratory results. So the initial investigations done were plasma glucose. Her HbA1c was 5.4. Her postprandial was 113.3 milligrams per deciliter. Her electrolytes, sodium 144 milli moles per liter, potassium 4.1 millimoles per liter, and calcium of 9.5 7 milligrams per deciliter. Her blood urea was 21 milligrams per deciliter. Her serum creatinine was 0.9 milligrams per deciliter. All were within the normal parameter. However, her urine osmolality was 81 millimole milliosmolality and serum osmolality of 302.8. And her prolactin level was 30.3 nanograms. Next. This led to the next set of investigation, her water deprivation test, where after deprivation, her urine osmolality was 150 milliosmoles, but on administration of desmopressin, it raised to 444 milliosmoles per kg. Next. Imaging studies. So the contrast image of the pituitary gland shows two T1 hypo-intense nodules on either side of the stalk in the anterior pituitary of size 0.43 and 4.4. millimeters, likely a microadenoma with the loss of T1 hyperintensity of posterior pituitary. This image shows one microadenoma. Next. And this image here to the far left and right shows two microadenomas, which are hypointense. Next. So on differential diagnosis, we can, on the basis of the chief complaints, a probable diagnosis are diabetes mellitus, hypercalcemia, chronic kidney disease, psychogenic polydipsia, and diabetes insipidus. But with the initial investigations, the above four can be ruled out. And with the confirmatory tests and imaging results, the diabetes insipidus can be concluded. Next. Hence, the patient was diagnosed with cranial diabetes insipidus with supracellular microadenoma of the anterior pituitary gland. She was treated with desmopressin nasal spray and was advised to use every day one spray on alternative nostrils. But the patient strictly followed this only for 3 years, following which she occasionally used and gradually discontinued, but no relapse of the symptoms were seen thereafter. Next. This was a scan taken the year 2015. Where the marked areas show pituitary gland, which is lesion-free. Next. And these images show that it is a partial empty cella. Next. Hence, the patient was finally diagnosed with a cranial diabetes insipidus with vanishing supracellular microadenoma of the anterior pituitary gland. To summarize, this is a 45-year-old female of 1 month history of polydipsia, polyuria, nocturia, dryness of mouth and limbs, a weight loss seen, blurring vision, diplopia, and headaches were not seen. And on investigation, serum osmolality was raised, urine osmolality was decreased, and water deprivation test showed good response to desmopressin. Her first MRI scan showed a microadenoma of the anterior pituitary, which then she was put on desmopressin, which she discontinued. And her second MRI scan shows the absence of the pituitary lesion and no relapse on discontinuing of the medications per se. Thank you for your time.
Over to you, sir, for the question and answer session.
Okay. A very tough case, presented very well. So both the second speaker also, presenter also, with full confidence, she presented. It's good, Shivapriya. Keep it up. So,
thank you.
My question is, who was the guide for you?
I didn't have a guide actually. So, yeah.
Where did you get the case from? Patient from?
It's my neighbor, sir.
It's your neighbor. Okay.
Yes.
No problem. So it's good that you found during this corona period, you got a good case. Okay, no problem. The workup I'll tell you. Sorry. Okay. My question is, for a microadenoma, what is the order of depletion of pituitary hormones?
Okay, so in case of my pituitary tumors, we can have either micro or macroadenoma or giant tumor. So in case of a functional pituitary adenoma, the cell type that composes the tumor can increase the secretion, where one or multiple hormones of the anterior pituitary can be secreted. Whereas in case of a non-functional anterior pituitary adenoma, that they do not secrete much of hormones, but they have a mass effect actually. So on the surrounding areas of the anterior pituitary and leading to hormonal deficiencies. And maybe sometimes even to optic chiasma and giving visual disturbances.
My question is, there's a pituitary adenoma, what will be the order of deficiency of pituitary hormones? Which hormones will first become deficient, then what are the last hormone to become deficient? That's what is the question. Is DA very common? That's all.
I think
if prolactin. If you prepared for this topic, you.
I think.
Prolactin secretes. It's a secretory tumor. Prolactinoma.
Yes, yeah, it's a prolactinoma, sir.
What is the last hormone? What is the first hormone? What is the first hormone to become deficient? What is the last hormone to fill? No problem. You leave it. No problem. It's a tough question, but for this case, you should have read that. No issues. So the patient's urine osmolality is less than 100, right? It was 84.
Yes, right? Sir. That was 81. That was a random sample which was taken by because she was advised by her family physician to take
it. It is 81.
Yes, sir.
What is the diagnosis?
81, so it is decreased osmolality, so I think it's diabetic insipidus, but it can also be psychogenic polydipsia. But with the presence of, on initial investigation, her sodium levels showed that it was not a psychogenic polydipsia.
No, no issues, no problem. You have prepared it, but if any urine osmolality less than 100, is DA, that's all.
Okay yes.
It's DA. Psychogenic yes. polydipsia will not bring down the urine osmolality to less than 100.
Yes.
There's no enough water deprivation test.
Yes.
What is the problem with water deprivation? How long you do a water deprivation?
In case of an adult, up to 6 to 12 hours is done for a water deprivation test.
Which are the patients you will not do water deprivation?
A patient who have extreme dehydration, presenting with extreme dehydration, and in case of infants, then who have psychogenic polydipsia maybe.
Okay, no problem. Good answer, no problem. So this patient did not need a despumbasin. The water deprivation was not needed for this patient. After water deprivation, you again do the urine osmolality, whether it is increasing or not. That's what should have been done, not despumbasin to be given. So no okay. issues, good presentation. So we'll go to the move on to the next presentation.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Our next presenter for the session will be Shreyans D. Singhvi. Over to you, Shreyan.
Am I audible?
Yes, Shreyan, you're audible.
Good evening. Good evening, Dr. Venkat Krishnan. I am Shreyans Singhvi from Srimati NHL Municipal Medical College in Ahmedabad. And I'm presenting a rare case of hydrated cyst of the intraventricular septum. Next. A hydrated disease or echinococcosis is a zoonotic disease caused by the larvae of the cystoid species of the genus Echinococcus, like examples are granulosis, multilocularis, vogeli, or oligarthus. The humans acquire the primary cystic echinococcuses by the ingestion of E. granulosis eggs excreted by the infected carnivores, usually canines. Humans are not the definitive host of the disease. There are several intermediate hosts of echinococcus. They get infected from the parasite by ingesting the eggs of the parasite and in the viscera of these hosts, the eggs develop into the larval stages. Humans are accidental hosts of the disease. The infection may be acquired by contact with the infected definitive hosts, egg-containing feces or egg-contaminated plants or soil followed by their ingestion. The disease is known to occur in all continents except Antarctica and in 100 countries worldwide. Hydrated disease is endemic in India. For India, the highest prevalence has been reported from the erstwhile state of Andhra Pradesh, Tamil Nadu, and the Swarashtra region of Gujarat. Next. So, the case history of the patient. A 36-year-old female patient presented to the OPD of the medicine department of a tertiary care hospital of Ahmedabad with the chief complaints of occasional chest pain and dyspnea on accustomed exertion since the past 1 month. The general physical examination was performed. She was well alert and oriented on to time, place, and person. Her vitals were taken, which were normal. She was afebrile and her blood pressure recorded was 100/60 mmHg and a saturation of 98% on room air. Furthermore, cardiac examination was performed during which cardiac auscultation revealed an ejection systolic murmur in the left parasternal region. Radiological examination was performed on the chest x-ray in the PA view. Nothing significant was found. Furthermore, when electrocardiography was done, there was a sinus rhythm, normal. And then later we performed a 2D echocardiography, which revealed a left ventricular ejection fraction of 66%. There were no regional wall abnormalities, a trivial MR, an aortic regurgitation, and a trivial tricuspid regurgitation. It also revealed an intraventricular septal cyst with mid-cavitary obstruction. Also, the left ventricular size appeared normal with fair left ventricular function with reduced left ventricular compliance. The next investigation performed was a multi-slice CT angiogram, which provided the following results. Profound evidence of a large, rounded, well-defined, thin-walled, minimally enhancing cystic lesion involving interventricular septum that was projecting towards both the right and the left ventricles at mid-cavity level with external compression over ventricular cavities, the left ventricle more than the right ventricle. This suggested the probable diagnosis of a hydatid cyst of approximate size of 48.3 by 36.5 millimeter in axial plane with the craniocaudal extent of 44.2 millimeter. Next. Here you can see the MSCT before the operation. Preoperatively, the hydatid cyst is visible, and postoperatively we can see a pseudoaneurysm after the cyst was removed in the CT. Next. The patient was started on oral albendazole and was referred to the CTVS department for the surgical excision of the cyst. The cyst was excised successfully, leaving behind a pseudoaneurysm. The diagnosis of hydatid cyst disease was confirmed by histopathological examination following the operation. The patient was discharged on oral albendazole following an uneventful postoperative stay. After the successful surgery, 2D echocardiography was performed, which had the following results. Left ventricular ejection fraction 60%, no regional wall abnormalities addressed. There was still presence of a mild mitral regurgitation, trivial aortic regurgitation, and mild tricuspid regurgitation. There was presence of a freely mobile structure attached to mid-septal capsule. There was absence of any effusion. Post-operatively, the cardiac multi-slice CT was performed, which gave the following results. Positive evidence of a thickened intraventricular septum with contrast filled out pouching within the intraventricular septum communicating with the left ventricular cavity, measuring approximately 28 by 10 millimeter in axial plane and 30 millimeter in craniocaudal extension, with the neck measuring 8 to 9 millimeter, suggesting a pseudoaneurysm formation. Next. Surgical management with oral albendazole therapy remains the mainstay of treatment. The main principle of surgical treatment is to empty the cyst, remove the daughter cysts and the germinative membrane, excise the pericyst, and then obliterate the residual cavity with sutures. The use of local solicital solutions such as hypertonic saline solution is obligatory after cystopericystectomy in order to minimize the risk of dispersion of the infective fluid. Next. These are my references, and I've also published this article, which was published actually last month. I've given this in a journal, International Journal of Advances in Medicine. So, next. Thank you.
So excellent presentation. So very happy to, it's a very rare presentation of echinococcus, hydatid cyst in the interventricular septum. It's a rare presentation. So in practice, it is almost not seen. So, but hydatid can occur anywhere, but most commonly it is the lung or the liver.
Liver.
Yes. So the question will be Sayant Singhvi, correct time?
Yes, sir.
Yes. So the question is, what is the definitive host and the intermediate host for echinococcus?
So the definitive host is the animal that injects it, and like, you know, sheep, cattle, horses, pigs, and mainly they are the dogs, actually the definitive host, and the intermediate host can be like dogs. Sheep. And, mainly dogs. Sorry, sir. Yes.
Okay. Sir. So you told interventricular septum, if there is septal defect, suppose there is a septal defect, what is the murmur you usually hear?
Septal defect.
Septal defect. What is the murmur heard?
I'm not sure. So is it a pansystolic murmur?
It is a pansystolic murmur. So this patient had an ejection systolic murmur, correct?
Yeah. Yes, sir.
So there was not a ventricular septal defect. It was an obstruction to the outflow tract. That is why the patient had an ejection systolic murmur.
Yes.
So what are the treatment modalities available for hydatid cyst?
So we generally we do a surgical treatment. We remove the cyst. We give albendazole or mebendazole which are the medications for it, antiparasitic, and the surgery we can do hepatectomy. If it depends on the size of the cyst, mainstay of the treatment is we should prevent the cyst from bursting or any other complications arising, and the leakage of the fluid. That is the mainstay. So we always look to remove the cyst as early as possible, and we also used solutions like saline solutions to make sure the entire cyst is cleared from the system.
How long you treat this patient?
So this patient was in the hospital for a week. Initially, the diagnosis was like it took 2 days for the diagnosis because as she presented to the medicine department, my own senior was the
what
one.
What is the duration of albendazole? I'm asking. What is the duration of albendazole? How long you'll give albendazole? How long you'll give mebendazole?
So albendazole is around preoperatively we give it like for a month to cause the sterilization of the cyst, and once the treatment is done, like we see for 3 months after that.
So I think you have to read the duration. No problem. Good presentation. All the best.
Yes.
You can move on to the next presentation. Thank you.
Our next presenter will be Aniruban Dev. Over to you, Aniruban.
Can you hear me and see me?
Yes, Aniruban, we can hear you, but we cannot see you, Aniruban.
You cannot see me?
Yes, now we can see you, Aniruban.
Okay. So today I'll be presenting. Good morning, one and all. Today I'll be presenting about a rare sporadic manifestation of von Hippel-Lindau syndrome. Next. There's my guide and co-guide. So next. A 46-year-old male presented with a headache for 5 days and giddiness for 5 days. About the elucidation of the history, the headache, the patient was apparently asymptomatic 5 days ago when he presented with a subacute onset of headache. It was progressive, it was holocranial, and it was dull aching type. Regarding the giddiness, it was a kind of head spinning, especially while walking, while there was no swaying or gait instability. Next. And there was no other history suggestive of cranial nerve, motor, and sensory deficits or any history of neck rigidity. He was a known case of autosomal dominant polycystic kidney disease on treatment for hypertension for the last 10 years. And regarding family history, he had no significant family history in his first or second degree relatives. Next. The physical examination was apparently normal except for a raised pulse rate and a blood pressure of 140/90. Next. Coming to his per abdominal examination, bilateral large masses were felt in both flanks, which had irregular boundaries, smooth surface, cystic consistency, and it was occupying the lumbar, iliac, and hypochondrial region on both sides, and it was bimanually palpable. Next. The CNS examination was also fairly normal, except for mild dysdiadochokinesia, which was bilaterally present. Next. So a provisional diagnosis of chronic Berry aneurysm rupture was made. So now we'll move on to the investigations. Next. So the CT scan brain was normal, contrary to our provisional diagnosis, and the RFT was also normal too. The ophthalmoscopy revealed a grade 4 hypertensive retinopathy. Next. The MRI of brain was done. It showed a well-defined homogeneously enhancing lesion in the region of obex of fourth ventricle. Can I move on to the next slide? As you can see, this MRI, it's a T1 weighted MRI, and there is a cystic non-enhancing component also to this solid well-enhancing lesion. And this was suggestive of a hemangioblastoma. Next. Now, CCT revealed bilaterally enlarged kidneys with multiple cystic lesions, and it had lost corticomandibular differentiation of both kidneys. And the walls and septations were enhancing, suggestive of Bosniak type 3 cysts. Next. So also, we found an incidentally discovered, well-defined, it had, though irregular margins, a heterogeneously enhancing mass in the pancreatic body, and it had main pancreatic duct dilatation too, which was suggestive of a malignant pancreatic mass arising from the ductal system. Next. So a genetic testing was done regarding we had suspicion of a von Hippel-Lindau syndrome. It showed a mutation in the exon 2 and the genetic testing was positive. So next, so we came to a final diagnosis of sporadic von Hippel-Lindau syndrome. Next. So regarding the management of follow-up, the patient was scheduled for a Whipple's procedure and a surgical excision of the hemangioblastoma was also scheduled. Next. But before the surgery, we had to evaluate the patient, whether the patient had a pheochromocytoma, which was to be done with an MIBG scan, and renal cell carcinoma with a renal biopsy. Next. So the discussion, why I'm taking up this case. A von Hippel-Lindau syndrome is a rare autosomal dominant disorder because of mutation in the VHL tumor suppressor gene. 20% of the cases are sporadic and the incidence is only 1 in 36,000. It can be divided in two subsets based on the susceptibility to presence of pheochromocytoma or not. Next. So this is a diagnostic criteria. Clinically, it can be diagnosed if there are two typical VHL tumors or if there is a family history with one typical VHL tumor or there has to be a one genetic testing. Next. So regarding the significance of this presentation, I can attribute it to the sporadic presentation of the disease. The long-standing secondary hypertension was probably due to multiple cyst in kidney, whereas in VHL syndrome, we know that it is mostly attributable to pheochromocytoma. Also, the multiple renal cysts were present, and Bosniak type 3 is highly likely that the patient had a malignancy too. And the malignant appearance of pancreatic mass is not that well documented in VHL patients. You can see that 50 to 60% of pancreatic cystic diseases are common, but they are mostly asymptomatic and benign, and malignancy is not the dictum. Next. Next. So here, I would like to conclude that headache in a patient with polycystic kidney disease needs evaluation behind hypertension or Benny aneurysm, and the preserved renal function despite a large cystic kidney disease should prompt search for other typical VHL markers. Next. So these are my references. Next. Next. And thank you.
So, Boon Narajan, an excellent presentation with the way you prepared and the confidence and the voice, yes. The voice with which you present, it's a plus point for everyone, not alone for it. You should learn how to present and the advantage of this is you're not seeing me in front actually, it is not a direct one. Then with that, you should be able to present with confidence. Somebody is not in front of you, it is always that. You should have that confidence, but your voice is excellent and the presentation was very clear. So the questions from my side, so exon of which chromosome?
So exon, it was exon 2 of the VHL gene located in the short arm of chromosome 3.
Chromosome 3, okay. So what are the malignant tumors in association with VHL?
The VHL, the most common malignancy that is associated is renal cell carcinoma of the clear cell type, and the second most common is the pheochromocytomas. The rest of the tumors are mostly benign.
So what is the pancreatic tumor that is in association, commonly in association?
Commonly, benign tumors are generally serous cystadenomas or pancreatic neuroendocrine tumors, which have been reported to metastasize. So, but this tumor had main pancreatic dilatation, which was suggestive of a ductal origin.
So, what was the follow-up of the patient? What happened to the patient further?
The patient was followed up with an MIBG scan and it revealed extra-adrenal pheochromocytoma. I could not get the reports because I had come back to my home from my college. So I could not follow up the patient. The patient had developed a pheochromocytoma and his surgery was delayed for that reason because he had to undergo adequate pre-op management because he was scheduled for a Whipple's and the surgical hemangioblastoma excision. But now we have to deal with the pheochromocytoma first. So the rest details I actually don't know because I could not follow up because of the lockdown.
Okay, thanks, Anirban. Thank you for the nice presentation. We'll move on to.
Welcome.
Our next presenter will be Naina Das. Over to Naina.
Am I audible?
Yes, Naina, you're audible.
And am I visible as well?
Yes.
So, good evening to everyone present here. I am Naina Das and I'm going to present a case of Ewing sarcoma of the patella, which is an extremely rare entity. Next. So, to begin with the introduction, Ewing sarcoma is a small blue round cell tumor. It's a primary bone malignancy. It is a relatively rare tumor with 6 to 8% of all malignant bone tumors, which mostly affects 5 to 20 years of age, that is the young adults. And it is only the second most common sarcoma of bone in children and young adults after osteosarcoma. Next. Moving on, it has a slight male preponderance and mostly occurs either in the diaphysis or the metadiaphyseal region of long bones. The other bones which where it can occur include pelvis, ribs, vertebra, clavicle, etc. About 30% cases are metastatic at presentation, which present with micrometastasis, and about 95% cases show a reciprocal somatic translocation between the 11 and 22nd chromosomes, leading to the formation of a fusion oncoprotein. Next. Moving on to the brief history of the patient, she was a 21-year-old female who came to us with chief complaints of non-radiating dull pain of the left knee. She had a progressive increase in swelling at the anterior aspect of the left knee for about 2 years and had restricted mobility of the left leg for about 1 year. However, there was no history of trauma. Next. Moving on to the examination, her general survey findings were normal. The local examination, we found that the restricted mobility of left leg was present. There was a mobile, slightly tender swelling present over the left knee, whose surfaces were irregular, edges were ill-defined, dimensions were about 8 centimeters into 4 centimeters. The local temperature was raised and it was firm in consistency. Next. Moving on, the other examinations, including the systemic examination, other joints and lymph nodes were normal. There was no distal neurovascular deficit and the capillary refill time was less than 3 seconds. Next. Moving on to the investigation, firstly, a complete blood count was done where the only significant findings was that she was mildly anemic with a hemoglobin of 10.2 milligram per deciliter. Next. Moving on, an X-ray was done. Patella was expanded in size. The lytic lesion was seen with fine separations. Cortex was thinned out with a focal breach and corticomedullary differentiation was lost. Also, additionally, we can see an onion peel skeening, which is typically found in the X-ray of this patient. Next. Moving on to the CT scan, we see an expansile lytic patellar lesion with focal breach in the cortex, which is involving the soft tissue. It shows the impression of an osteosarcoma or a giant cell tumor. On the MRI, we can see an hyperintense lesion involving the patella with bony destruction and an extension to the adjacent soft tissues, which is also suggestive of a malignant neoplastic lesion. Next. A PET CT scan was done for the patient where we can see that the metabolically active lytic expansile lesion in the left patella can be seen as in the second image. The cortical destruction and large soft tissue mass in the prepatellar area, which is also extending into the knee joint. However, there was no evidence of any active distant macrometastasis. Next. The core needle biopsy of the patellar mass was done. Histopathologically, it revealed small round cells, which were hyperchromatic round nucleus, scanty pale to eosinophilic cytoplasm, and an indistinct cell border. Cells were arranged in sheets divided into irregular nests by fibrovascular septa, and more than occasional mitosis and foci of necrosis were also noted. Infiltration into the soft tissues can be seen. Next. Following this, we reach the differential diagnosis for this case, which are other small round cell tumors, including Ewing sarcoma, small cell variant of osteosarcoma, lymphoplastic lymphoma, and mesenchymal chondrosarcoma. Next. So the immunohistochemical staining was performed for this patient, which was the mainstay of diagnosis in this case, which showed a diffuse membranous positivity of CD99. However, CD45 was negative, which rules out lymphoblastic lymphoma in this case. Next. So we reached a final diagnosis of Ewing sarcoma of the left patella for this patient. Next. Management. The patient was ideally managed by patellectomy with wide excision and ligament reconstruction. Adjuvant radiotherapy and chemotherapy are scheduled for the patient to be followed up. Next. So after batelectomy, the gross pathological specimen was collected. The pathological specimen, as we can see from the picture, is a partially skin-covered globular soft tissue mass with ulcerated area of the skin. On cut section, we can see a fleshy grayish-white growth involving the patella. Next. On microscopic examination of the section from this mass, we could see that the soft tissue and deeper resection of the planes were grossly involved by the tumor, which is also corresponding to the previous findings of histopathology in our case. Next. So moving on to the case discussion, we can understand that Ewing sarcoma, although a relatively common tumor, the location of the tumor in the patella is an extremely rare case. So the patient underwent ideal management procedure after her diagnosis. Primary malignant tumors of the patella, although very uncommon, should be considered in the differential diagnosis of any patellar lesion, because early detection and prompt initiation of treatment in these cases improves the prognosis of a patient significantly. These are my references below. Next. Thank you for your patient hearing.
Yes. Naina Das, very happy. So all the presenters, I should appreciate the confidence with which they are presenting. And their presentation is very clear and without much disturbances in their speech or any hiccups in their presentation. So that means they are prepared well, very well. So the question from my side, what is the genetic association of Ewing's? Is there any genetic
association? I can't hear you.
Sorry. Is there any genetic association?
Sir, I can't
hear you. Are you able to hear me?
Yes, sir. Yes, I can hear you now. Yes.
Is there any specific genetic or a chromosomal abnormality you see in Ewing's?
Yes, sir. So, as I mentioned, the most common one, which is found in almost 90 to 95% cases, is the reciprocal translocation between the chromosomes 11 and 22, leading to the formation of the EWSR1 FLI1 protein. There are less common mutations as well, which can occur, such as the translocation between chromosomes 7 and 22. Then, sir, there are also translocations which involve the formation of oncoproteins like EWSR1 FEV, EWSR1 ERG, EWSR1 ETV1, ETV4. These mutations are also found.
What is the survival rate of Ewing sarcoma?
With the ideal management procedure, 5-year survival rate 70 to 80% with the newer treatment policies.
What are the common sites of Ewing sarcoma?
So the common sites of Ewing sarcoma include the axial parts of the axial skeleton, such as it can include the spine, it can include the pelvic bones. Then, so it can include the long bones, mostly the most common site, including femur, followed by tibia, and humerus also is included. Then, sir, these are the most common osseous sites where Ewing sarcoma can be found.
What are the other locally invasive tumors, bone tumors?
Sir, it includes giant cell tumor and chondroblastoma amongst the benign but locally invasive bone tumors.
Okay, very good. Thank you. We'll move on to the next presentation.
Our final presenter for today's session will be Tanisha Singh. Over to you, Tanisha.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Good evening, distinguished judge, Dr. Krishnan Murthy, organizers, and my fellow presenters. I am Tanisha Singh, a second-year student of MBBS from Sri Ramachandra Medical College, Chennai, and I dedicate this presentation on collision tumor, a case report, to my teacher and guide, late Dr. Chandran Mohan, and my present guide, Dr. Vasugi, both from Sri Ramachandra Medical College. Next. My presentation is about a 66-year-old male patient coming in with complaints of dysphagia, cough with wheezing, and chest pain after oral intake of food for nearly a month. He also complained of persistent fever and loss of weight and appetite. He has been a chronic smoker for 15 years. Next. Physical examination reveals that the patient is moderately malnourished and has facial puffiness. Respiratory system examination reveals dilated veins in the chest and decreased vesicular breath sounds in both lungs with otherwise normal vitals. The initial clinical diagnosis made was of lung malignancy. Next. These were some of the investigations which were done on the patient. Next. The blood test, serology test, and urine test were normal. The radiology revealed an ill-defined soft tissue mass in the anterior mediastinum. Next. Next, please. Yeah. So radiology revealed an ill-defined soft tissue mass in the anterior mediastinum with its epicenter in the superior and anterior mediastinum infiltrating into the left hilar region and the upper lobe of the right lung and encompassing both the bronchi. Next, please. The mass also infiltrates into the posterior wall of esophagus with narrowing of lumen, which was seen with the oral contrast. Next. As you can see in the right picture, the mass was obliterating the lumen of the esophagus for about 8 centimeters. Next, please. The mass extended from the level of thoracic vertebrae 2 to the level of thoracic vertebrae 6. Next. The biopsy of the mass was performed. The anterior portion was biopsied by transbronchial approach and the esophageal portion was biopsied through the upper gastrointestinal endoscopy. The histopathological analysis of the specimens revealed the anterior bronchial mass showed a cellular lesion of round to oval cells composed of hyperchromatic blue cells with streaming nucleus. Areas adjacent to it showed alveoli with fibrosis and necrosis. The monotonous population of the individual cells stained positive for CD56 and synaptophysin, rendering a diagnosis of small cell carcinoma. Next. The biopsy of the mass infiltrating the esophagus shows a nest of dysplastic squamous epithelium, which infiltrates into the muscularis propria. This is diagnosed as a moderately differentiated squamous cell carcinoma. Next, please. Adjacent tissues of the esophageal growth show multiple fragments of squamous epithelium with necrotic tissue in vicinity and acute inflammatory exudate. Few cells show multinucleation, molding and margination of chromatin. This is indicative of herpes-associated esophagitis. So, next please. So, the final diagnosis made was of collision tumor composed of small cell carcinoma and squamous cell carcinoma with superadded herpes esophagitis. Next. The patient was administered with platinum-based chemotherapy and has completed 3 cycles till now. Next. This case takes us to the discussion on collision tumor. Collision tumors are rare neoplasms consisting of 2 different tumor cell populations developing in juxtaposition to one another. They are thought to be composed of 2 neighboring independent neoplasms because of a common carcinogenic stimulus evoking a neoplastic response in the 2 adjacent but different types of epithelium. Only a few cases have been reported in literature. They are commonly found in males in the age group of 53 to 76 years. Next, please. Most of these patients present with dysphagia as the tumor grows easily into the mediastinal cavity and encloses the esophagus. The collision tumors are usually found at the gastroesophageal junction, with most cases being reported in the lower third of the esophagus. Next slide, please. The histopathological and immunohistochemical analysis are helpful in making the final diagnosis. Squamous cell carcinoma is easy to diagnose because the tumor cells show infiltrative growth pattern with nuclear atypia, but the small cell carcinomas are poorly differentiated endocrine carcinomas. Next, please. The guidelines for diagnosis collision tumor include, number 1, 2 distinct topographically separate sites of origin for the 2 components must be present. Number 2, there must be at least some separation of the 2 components so that despite intimate mixing at 2 points of juxtaposition, the dual origin can still be made out. Number 3, at the areas of collision, in addition to intimate mixing of the 2 components, some transitional zone may also be seen. The 3 possible mechanisms for the development of collision tumor are, the 2 primary tumors may develop adjacent to each other at the same time. or one tumor develops and changes the local microenvironment to promote the development of second tumor, or the third, or the two types of tumors share a common origin of pluripotent precursor stem cells that differentiate into the components of tumor cell types. Next. The upcoming three slides are some of the cases which I found on the net, which showed the same case. So can you skip to the second, to the next slide? And next slide. And one more slide, please. Yeah. So the biological behavior of these neoplasms is not well established because of the rarity of these neoplasms. The small cell component of the combined tumor confers the extremely aggressive tumor biology, and thus these tumors should be managed like primary small cell carcinomas. Prognosis depends on the state of the tumor at the time of initial diagnosis. So I would like to conclude by saying that these tumors are clinically relevant and physicians should be aware of it and not overlook it. Next slide, please. These are my references. I would like to end here. Thank you so much for your patient hearing, everyone.
Over to you, sir, for the question and answer session.
Yes. Thank you. Thank you for the, again, the session, clear presentation with confidence.
Thank you.
So sir, my question to you is, what is a composite tumor?
Sorry, sir, I can't hear you.
Composite tumor.
Hello.
What is a composite tumor? I can type in the chat box. Yes, Ignatius.
Yes, sir.
Composite tumor. What is a composite tumor?
Yes, sir, I can hear you now. Okay, sorry, sir. So composite tumors, even they have two tumors, but they have different origins and pathology, and they are actually in a close proximity to each other. And the histologic, there is a histologic intermingling of the tumors as well. But here in collision tumor, there is no intermingling of the tumors. And you can see that the two tumors have a different, have different origin.
What is a carcinosarcoma?
I'm so sorry, sir. I wouldn't know that.
What is cancer to cancer metastasis? See, what you presented is a classical composite tumor. See, there should be epithelial component and a sarcomatous component to say it is a collision tumor. Yes. Here, two cell types are there.
Yes, sir.
Very classical. In the same single tumor, you get two different histological pattern. That's all is there, which is
yes,
definitely separated. That is what is in this presentation, in this picture.
Yes,
so it
sir.
Is a classical composite tumor. For a collision tumor, there should be epithelial component along with the sarcomatous component. That is a classical collision tumor. So all are mingled, but a classical collision is, the exact definition is epithelial component along with the sarcomatous component. So this is a very classical composite tumor. So what was done for the patient? What was the follow-up of the patient?
Sir, the patient was started on a platinum-based chemotherapy. Till now, he has completed 3 cycles. And we also did an ultrasound to see if the cancer has metastasized to other organs, but it has not metastasized till now.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you once again, Tanisha. Thanks for the presentation. Okay. So Ignatius.
Yes, sir. We thank you very much for being our judge here for our case presentation, sir. We would request you to say a few words to our presenters, sir, who are presented before you.
So first of all, so the organizers have to be congratulated for the commendable job bringing presenters from all over India. That is not an easy job during this corona period. It's a pandemic. It's a very, very, it's a tough one. It's a tough task. And I was surprised to see abstracts from colleges from everywhere. So from north, east, everywhere, in Ahmedabad. Everywhere I saw a lot of papers had come. It was really interesting to see all the abstracts. I had chosen the 6 best abstracts as per various criteria, but all the 6 have done excellent. Excellent in the sense, what you have done is the presentation, the confidence with which you presented, that's what mattered today. Not the content, what is the answer you gave, that is not an issue. For your level, your presentation was very clear, what you wanted to present, and your slide preparations were very good actually. So to Ignatius.
Thank you, Savi. Once again, thank you for being our judge here. Thank you, sir. Yes.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thanks, everyone. Yes. All the best for you. All the best for you.